Please be seated. The record will show the presence of the jury, the defendant, and all counsel. Mr. Martinez.
When the law is on your side, you argue the law. When the facts are on your side, you argue the facts. But when nothing is on your side, you just argue. And that's what you have. Specifically, there was some mention, perhaps, of somebody's haircut. Does anybody care about Mr. Nurmi's haircut? Was that any part of the evidence that you should consider? There was also some talk about sexual orientation. Whose sexual orientation are we talking about? And did that present itself from the witness stand? Because remember, you are told that your duty is to follow what's in the jury instructions, and the jury instructions don't indicate that you consider anything other than the exhibits and the testimony that came through from that witness stand. So what you heard with regard to those two issues was perhaps just argument. And it was argument that was geared to somehow stir some sympathy in you. The other issue, for example, that you heard that was just argument was with regard to Exhibit 160. This involved Mr. Alexander, and there was talk about the fact that how could she have possibly stabbed him in that fashion if she was standing up? Well, according to her own testimony, she was crouched down at the time that this photograph was taken. And that's why the camera didn't have to go very far. The other issue that he indicated was, how could she possibly do it with her left hand? I mean, and how clumsy it would be. Has somebody forgotten, or has everybody forgotten that she indicated that she's ambidextrous? When she was asked by the prosecutor as to whether or not she could write with her left or right hand, she indicated, I'm ambidextrous. So perhaps those are the things that should be remembered when arguments are being made. The third issue that was brought up was, well, it involved the alleged pedophilia. If she really wanted to cause him some damage, she really wanted to cause Mr. Alexander some damage, why didn't she go to the media about it before this took place, if she really was going to do something like that? Well, if you remember the testimony, in August of 2011, there was a hearing involving an issue with regard to the pedophilia. And at that time, there were some magazines. And one of those magazines was the Photo Pro magazine, which is on my weird approach.
You may continue.
Maybe if you just have an argument, you'll forget about Exhibit 465, which is the Photo Pro magazine. Remember, she's such an avid person who knows all about cameras, an individual who's very interested in that. And in anticipation of that hearing, well, with regard to Exhibit 468, which is in evidence, you can find it in the magazine on page 6, and we'll look at it if need be. She wrote the name of Mark Stanek, who is with ABC News. And there's a number there. Do you think that she was writing him just to exchange greetings in anticipation of that hearing? Is that what you think was going on?
Objection, states the evidence.
Overruled.
Do you really think that's what she was doing? Do you think that they had a personal relationship? Do you think that Mr. Stanek is not busy with other issues? No. She contacted him in anticipation of that hearing because
objection,
she wanted...
Objection, states the evidence. Can we approach?
I'll sustain that objection.
This defendant contacted him for a reason.
Objection, arguing facts not in evidence.
Sustained.
You do
move
see...
Move to strike, Your Honor.
The jury will disregard.
You do see his name there, don't you? And you do see a number there. And additionally, with regard to those coded messages, with regard to trying to spread this and whether or not they were true, one of the things that the defendant indicated, defense counsel indicated, well, these were true. They were absolutely true, and there's nothing out there that indicates that they were not true. But if you take a look at Exhibit 469, with regard to these allegations, and this comes from an individual who was so absolutely upset with Mr. Alexander when he used the word fuck, according to her, well, in that magazine, page 43, this is
starting... Objection, Your Honor, scope.
Overruled.
Page 43, she writes, you fucked up. What you
Objection
told my...
Objection, misstates the evidence, Your Honor.
Sustained. Sustained.
You sustained it? Or...
Approach.
With regard to these magazines, you will remember that the testimony with regard to these magazines, they were taken from the defendant. They were in her possession. They were Exhibit 465. Shows that they were her magazines. They have her name on there, her address on there, and she was in possession of them. And she was in possession of them shortly before this hearing involving an aspect of this pedophilia allegation. And this defendant, at some point when she was having a visitor by the name of Ann Campbell, if you remember, during cross-examination, had these two magazines, this one and the Star magazine. And one of the guards, or one of the detention officers, was walking her down the hallway. And as she was walking her down the hallway, the defendant indicated to her, and this was shortly before this hearing involving an aspect of this pedophilia, indicated to this detention officer, or requested from this detention officer, that she be allowed to give this magazine, which is the Photo Pro magazine, exhibit number 465, along with exhibit number 466, which is the Star magazine, to her friend Ann Campbell. And after these magazines were reviewed by the sheriff's office personnel, and after they were put together, this is the message in exhibit 469 that could be gleaned. And it was, you fucked up. What you told my attorney next day.
This is still beyond the scope.
Directly contradicts what I've been saying for over a year. Get down here ASAP and see me before you talk to them again and before you testify so that we can fix this. Interview was excellent. Must talk ASAP. And if there's more writing to be looked at, you can take a look at the January 24, 2008 entry of her journal in which she indicates that nothing noteworthy has happened when it refers to the pedophilia allegation. So yes, she was very much engaged or using this pedophilia allegation. The other issue that was raised was, well, with regard to the can of gasoline that was purchased at the Walmart in Salinas, California. One of the things that was advanced to you as part of their argument, because it is just argument, was that she did purchase this 5-gallon can of gasoline, but that she returned it. If you remember on cross-examination, one of the questions that was asked of the defendant, did you return it to that same Walmart in Salinas? And her answer was yes.
Overrule if the jury is directed to recall the evidence.
Immediately after that, the prosecutor asked her, would it surprise you if I told you that they had no record of that gas ever being returned to that Walmart? And her answer was, yes, it would surprise me because they gave me a refund in cash.
Objection, so,
overruled again, the jury is directed to recall the testimony.
So she knew, or she told you specifically, that it was that same Walmart that, where she purchased the gas can, that she actually returned it. Additionally, if you take a look at the Walmart receipt, exhibit number 237.008, there's no markings on it. There is no indications whatsoever that it was ever touched by a Walmart employee. There's no indication that, for whatever reason, maybe the heavens created the one and only exception for her, that the employee would not put a notation on there that there had been a refund. That absolutely would not have happened. But they want you to believe that, because the only way that her story makes sense, the only way that there is no premeditation in this case, the only way that they can get you to believe that perhaps it's a second degree or manslaughter or believe the self-defense is that if somehow you say to yourself, that's okay. She can lie to us about this gas can all she wants. But even though she looked us right in the face and lied to us about this gas can, we're going to disregard that lie. Because we've gone to the Alice Laviolette school where there are certain things that are called white lies. Perhaps it's because it's on a white receipt that this is a white lie. Perhaps because it's one of five of those items there, that somehow it's a small percentage of a lie. But a lie is a lie, and she looked right at you in the face in response to one of your questions and told you that. And you also know that she did not return this gas can for refund by looking at the receipts from the ARCO in Pasadena, California. There is exhibit 237.001, a purchase for 8.301 gallons. That's for her car. You then have another purchase here, 237.012, That is 9.594 gallons. That's the 2 5-gallon cans.
Objection, arguing facts not in evidence.
Overruled.
Then you have 237.013, the one that was a little hard to see. And this one, you can tell, 2.27 gallons, that certainly will fit in a 5-gallon can. And if you have trouble believing that, you will remember the testimony of Chelsea Young, who indicated that in Salt Lake City, there were three different purchases of gas. One for 5.09 gallons, which was done at the pump. There was also another purchase for approximately a little bit under 10 gallons, which would represent the two other 5-gallon cans. And then there was another purchase for gasoline, the one for her car, mimicking or almost the same as the gas purchases in Pasadena. And if the purpose was to save money, which is what's been alleged, then why buy gas in Southern California? Why not buy gas there in Pasadena and then buy some gas in Arizona if that's where she was coming from? Because they argued to you, and it was all argument, that, well, every part of her trip was documented. And she was stopping at the bank. She was stopping at the store. And if she wanted to, she could have thrown away the receipt. Yes, every part of her trip was documented, except the part where she came to Arizona. That one was not documented. Everything having to do with Arizona was erased. The telephone, well, you know, they told you, she's not the first person to have her battery run low. Well, she's the first person we know that killed someone, and when that battery seemed to have just run low exactly when she came into Arizona, right outside of Pasadena. And this charger that she claims to have lost, all of a sudden she found that charger. The other things that we know is there are no indications at all that when she came here to the state of Arizona, she stopped for gas anywhere. She had those gas cans so that she wouldn't be able to be identified anywhere near Mr. Alexander's home. Additionally, with regard to the license plate, they tell you, well, that's one of the best ways in the world to get stopped, to drive without a license plate. Nobody ever alleged that she was driving without a license plate. The allegation by the state, which is borne out by the fact that the front plate is off and the back plate is upside down, is that she took both license plates off before she arrived at Mr. Alexander's house so she could park the car there and nobody would be wiser. Nobody would know that it was her that was there. Who would know that? They tell you, well, she could have borrowed her parents' cars. That's true, she could have done that. If they had license plates on them, they would have been identified to her. It would have been one short step to find out who owned that particular car. So you were also told, well, there were some guns that her father owned. Can you imagine the question the answer? If she went to her father and said, I need a gun, I want a gun. The question would have been, well, why is that you need it? Why would you possibly need it if you're going on a trip? And where are you going? What are you doing? Or else I'm not going to give you the gun. All of this is nothing but argument that was presented to you. And it was presented to you in a way so that you could not focus in on the actual issues in this case. One of the other portions of the argument was that, well, you were talked about the finger issue. You were shown photographs, and they talked to you about the demonstration. But as part of that argument, perhaps they forgot to talk to you about the cross-examination and the issue involving the finger. Because when she was being questioned about the murder, and she was being asked about this particular finger and how the injury had happened and how many injuries she had suffered as a result of the attack, if you will, on Mr. Alexander, she said, well, you know, I did get some bumps and bruises. The question was, is that all? Is there anything else? I mean, that's all that you received? And she said, I also cut my finger. That's what she said. So if that's what she said, then why aren't we talking about it now? Well, the reason we're not talking about it now is because they know that it doesn't help their case, so let's go ahead and make an argument. The other thing that was going on in this case is that there were a lot of the salacious details of the case that were resurrected for you. There was tape that was played, but of course the tape that was played didn't have her, generally speaking, didn't have her side of the comments on it. It didn't include all of the comments that you heard before. It just included Mr. Alexander's. So clearly, those were taken out of context. You were shown a photograph of her laying back nude, and you were asked to look. Take a look at her. Does that look like somebody that is really happy? I defy anybody, even Alice Laviolette, to take a look at a photograph. Take a look at a photograph and tell you exactly what an individual is thinking. Is there any way to take a look at the photographs of Mr. Alexander or the defendant in whatever pose she's in, whatever state of undress she's in, and tell you this is what she was thinking? No, she wasn't enjoying it. And then they talk to you about, well, she didn't consent to having sexual intercourse with him. And anywhere that you go, well, this would be a sexual assault. If there were a sexual assault when supposedly he had this incident, because there's really nothing to support it, when he had this, according to her, this intercourse with her, wouldn't she have reported it? Would she have gone to the bishop? And even though that may have happened, given relationships that occur, a person can consent afterwards and say, oh, you know, I really didn't want to, but it's okay. There's never any indication that stopped them.
Overruled.
There's never any indication that afterwards it didn't happen. And in fact, she talked in great detail on May 10th of 2008 when they were having that conversation about how much she liked that sort of activity. She talked about how she was asleep and he was doing something to the lower portion of her body and how she enjoyed being woken up that way. Well, isn't it the same thing that happened when supposedly she was asleep and he was having sexual intercourse with her? But that's not something that fits within their, if you will, spin on things, and so they make an argument on it. The other thing that they said is that, well, maybe she was just his booty call. Maybe she was his first, his second booty call, but bottom line is that she was his booty call. Why don't they talk about the May 26, 2008 instant messaging where Mr. Alexander indicated something to the contrary. He indicated that if we're going to be using these terms that are floating down the gutter, that he was the individual who was nothing more than a dildo with a heartbeat. And that it appears that whenever the defendant wanted anything, she would use her sexuality, and he was acknowledging it, that, yeah, I'm your booty call. So whose booty call is it? Is it hers or is it his? But they don't want you to think about that. They don't want you to talk about that because, again, it's easier to just go ahead and make the argument. They also talk to you about whether or not the defendant actually lied to you about Chrysler. And then, and we have an exhibit here, 523, that they showed you. And in it, you do see that on 6-9 of 2008, there's a charge of $233.97 to Budget Rent-A-Car, Redding, California. And if you take a look at, throughout this whole document, it indicates the merchants that are receiving the payments. The payments for which this defendant contracted for. These are the activities that she engaged in. Just like the journals. What they want you to do is, and they make the argument is, don't believe what's written there. You need to apply the law of attraction to these documents, don't you know? Or maybe you need to go back when you go in the jury room and actually sit down to a viewing of a secret, because it appears that that is what's going to provide you with the ability to be able to read these documents that are being presented. And when this document says, for example, that we have on 6-20, there's a Sacramento County Airport, and then you also have the, let me find it, on 6/16 for $246.99. Priceline.com Air. And it tells you that the name of the merchant for that was Priceline. And the significance of that is not that she flew down here. The significance of that is that when that service is used, they note it. There is no indication that between the 9th, 6/9, and 6/16, which is a week time difference, there's no indication that between that week, that Priceline somehow changed their billing practices. That's what they want you to believe. It just so happens that during that time, Priceline decided to do things differently when it came to billing the merchants and how it was that they handled things. See, you can rent a car according to their theory and have it go through budget, but if it's an airline ticket within the same time, well, then they follow a totally different procedure. They wanted to talk to you also about the events at the home. And they indicated to you that they wanted to you to use your common sense. They indicated that they wanted you to consider the voice of reason. And they asked you that over and over again. And that voice of reason, the way they presented it to you, was the defendant's version of events. So when the argument was made, as to the voice of reason, it was nothing more than the defendant's version of events. When they, for example, when they talked to you about the tying up on that slave bed, and they said, shouldn't be too difficult to do, but you can actually tie her up. And then they showed you a photograph of what potentially it could be. True, you could. But the problem here is, was she tied up with just her wrists around the headboard? Or was she tied up also on her feet? Which story do you want to believe? She told two stories. It always goes back to that one issue. There's more than one story that she gave. So which one are you going to decide to believe? Is it going to be that she had both her feet tied or her ankles tied? Or are you going to decide that it was just her ankles? Is it just her hands? That's the problem with what they are presenting to you. And then they also showed you photographs, for example, of the stairs and how there was this picture of this, what appeared to be, to them, a piece of the rope. Go with exhibit number 269 that was on the stairs. That one. What's interesting about that, though, if she was doing that, where are the footsteps with the blood on it? If she was so hysterical, where are the footsteps with the blood on it? If she was walking around that bedroom, looking around for this belt, I'm sorry, for this rope, certainly the indicator always was that this was after the killing, that she took it with her. So, how come around the bedroom? Because presumably, she at one point said that the knife was on the nightstand, and that's where the knife, that's where the cutting of the rope was, because she said she at least was tied up by her wrists. How come there is no footprints and blood there? How come there's no footprints and blood here? The reason that there isn't is because there wasn't any rope. She's just trying to justify what happened on that day in order to allow for a knife to be present so that it makes her story palatable to you. Again, you have to have this extra step. You have to have sort of a code in order to understand what she's saying, in order to understand what she is writing. They talk to you about a timeline, and they talk to you about a photograph where Mr. Alexander is looking into the camera as the starting point. However, when the state showed you this photograph, This is the photograph, as the state mentioned, that was the last photograph that shows him before the attack when he was living. That was what the statement was by the state. The next, and that's at 5:30:30. The next photograph that the state contends is where the stabbing is going on is Exhibit 161, which is at 5:31:14. So, in those 44 seconds, between that photograph and this photograph, is there time to go into the bedroom to get a knife? Is there time to go into the bedroom to get a purse that might have a knife and a gun? And that's what happened in this case. Oh, wait a minute. Can you just wait a minute? I need to go get my purse. I need to go do that. And then this is when you have the attack. There were many, many possible scenarios that they talked to you about. And one of them involved the sink when there was this blood all over it, and there was smudges all over it. And one of the things that they told you, well, if it was her that was doing it, and if she was able to puncture his stomach, how is it then that as he's standing over this sink, how is it then that if that is what's happening, how come they didn't go in deeply? Well, one of them, the reason is that, remember, there was blood all over the place and there was blood all over the knife, and she's already admitted that she cut herself during the attack with the knife. One of the reasons that it could be that it wasn't deep is that that's when she cut herself, and that's when she's going after him with her left hand, and blood has this consistency to it. She slipped on the handle, went to the blade, and then she cut herself. And if she cut herself and still wants to continue attacking him, it would mean that every time that she would stab him, it would probably hurt her. Everything that was presented to you is nothing more than argument with nothing to back it up. Nothing, that is, unless you believe what the defendant is telling you. If you believe what the defendant is telling you, then all of these arguments then do begin to make sense. But where do you draw the line? Where do you draw the line and believe this defendant when she's lied to everybody that she's come in contact with? And she's lied in other circumstances too, that maybe didn't involve her being under oath. One of the things that she lied about was the gun. According to her, back on June 10th of 2008, she said, well, you know, when I spoke to the officer, the gun, I made that up. It was a lie. Everything that she tells anybody of any consequence is a lie until she comes here, and then everything that she tells you, everything is the truth, except for the lies that she told you. And under those circumstances, and given that, they want you to step back and say, evaluate her self-defense claim. Evaluate this case and determine whether or not it's manslaughter, or whether or not it's second-degree murder. And make sure that you discount all of the elements of premeditation that the state has already discussed with you. For example, the .25 caliber gun that turned up missing after she took it in a burglary back on May 28th of 2008. And in terms of renting the car, overlook them. Everything else about that, the fact that she wanted a nondescript vehicle at a different place than where she lived, that she then, as in anticipation of that trip, forget the fact that she told Mr. Brewer that she was coming to Mesa and that she needed two gas cans. Forget all of that. Forget the fact that in Salinas she bought another gas can and she lied to you about that because that doesn't fit within her scheme, if you will. Then forget the fact that when she gets to Pasadena, she fills up those three gas cans. And forget the fact that she told you this story about these skateboarders because that doesn't fit within the story, but just go with the story that she told you. Forget all of that. All of that is just bad coincidences, as well as the fact that her phone somehow magically is not on during the time that she's here in Arizona. You would need to ignore all of that in order to find that there was a premeditation. Additionally, The jury instruction with regard to premeditation is much more clear than that and much more specific than that. It tells you that premeditation, in terms of time, does not necessarily have to be prolonged. So in this particular case, there are two types of premeditation. The one where she thought about it since May, the end of May 2008, and she made the preparations. And the other premeditation when she was at the house. He was killed in three different ways. The stab wound to the heart would have killed him. Obviously, the slitting of the throat would have killed him. And the shot to the face would have killed him. That, all of it, did not happen in one instance. It took a period of time. And that, although it was approximately 2 minutes, what this jury instruction tells you is that the time needed for reflection is not necessarily prolonged. And the space and time between the intent or knowledge to kill and the act of killing may be very short. It could be seconds. It could be 4, 5, 6 seconds. And in this case, there was more than that. What she did is she stabbed him first. He wasn't dying quick enough. And she was afraid he was going to live. As he stumbles away, tries to get away, she chases him down. Then she slits his throat and then for good measure shoots him in the face. And that's the only way that you can account for the casing where it is, falling on top of the blood. They did talk to you about what is called self-defense. And they said to you, well, we're not going to read the whole thing to you. We're just going to read a portion of it. And they read a portion of it that was on top of page 13. And they said to you, the use of deadly physical force is justified if a reasonable person in the situation would have reasonably believed that immediate deadly physical danger appeared to be present. Actual danger is not necessary to justify the use of deadly physical force in self-defense. And they said to you, the use of deadly physical force is justified if a reasonable person. And they said, she's a reasonable person. No, that's not what the statute says. The statute says, or the law says, a reasonable person. It doesn't say that the defendant is a reasonable person. The defendant is a liar and a killer. That's not what it says there. It says a reasonable person. A person that is involved in those circumstances. And that's not the defendant. It's not just because it's her, that's what we're talking about. But let's read the whole instruction. It's called justification for self-defense involving physical force. And again, there's going to be an argument. They made it for you, but they didn't give you the full argument. They didn't talk to you about the whole jury instructions. It tells you that a defendant is justified in using or threatening deadly physical force in self-defense if two conditions exist. And then it sets out for you what those two conditions are. It talks about a reasonable person in the situation. They're talking about not the defendant, but what a reasonable person. Presumably the way that the defense attorney explained it to you and the way that you were chosen, you are the reasonable people. You are the reasonable person, the way they explained it to you. A reasonable person in the situation would have believed that deadly physical force was immediately necessary. Here, in order for you to believe that this is deadly, that this is something that is available, you would have to believe that even after all of the lies, even after the fact that she presented evidence to you about these gas cans, about the fact that she used Priceline when she didn't, the fact that her journals say something when they say something else, the fact that she lied to her doctors, all of that, you have to decide that even in light of all of that, in light of all of that, you have to believe that force was immediately necessary because she told you so. That's the only way that you would know that it was immediately necessary, because she told you so. Why would why would deadly physical force be necessary after she stabbed him the first time? It wouldn't be. Why would deadly physical force be necessary after she slashed his throat? Everybody knows that the person, if you slash him that badly, is done. Everybody also knows, for example, if they want to take the shooting first, that if you shoot somebody in the head, that's it. Deadly physical force was immediately necessary. If you have already one of the two of the three killings already done, then you don't need to do the other two. And the reason that I point that out is because that shows that her intent here was to kill, not to defend herself. That's what she was doing. And then it talks about to protect against another's use or apparent attempted or threatened use of unlawful deadly physical force. What physical force do you see that Mr. Alexander applied to the defendant? What injuries was she able to talk to you about that Mr. Alexander inflicted upon her? Well, she claims that one was to the head, but there's no verification of that. The only injury that she had that day, the only injury that was verified that she had that day, was the injury to her left finger, and she said she got that stabbing him. So what injuries does she have? Or what use does he have? What threats do we have? Well, she says and claims that he said that he was going to fucking kill you, bitch. That's what she says that he said. But again, it's all predicated on believing a liar. Somebody who lied to you about important facts in this case. About things such as the gas can. Why would she have to lie about that? Because if she didn't, then the issue of premeditation is very clear. And number two, the defendant used or threatened no more deadly physical force than would have appeared necessary to a reasonable person in the situation. Well, what's a reasonable person in that situation? A reasonable person in that situation would see that the victim, Mr. Alexander, was naked. They would also see that he was sopping wet because he had just been in that shower. They would also see that he was sitting down when this happened. They would also see and know that not once in his lifetime, and that lifetime that was cut short, not once in that lifetime did he ever lay a hand on her. Not once. There is no evidence that he ever laid a hand on her, ever. So a reasonable person where this individual had never ever touched her, because you have to believe her and believe those journals that have to be interpreted through this, through the secret, through the law of attraction. You would have to believe her in order to believe that physical force was even necessary at all. There's no indication at all that he ever even touched her. There were situations, for example, when she told them, according to her journal, that she was leaving. And how did he respond to that? He kissed her tenderly three times. Is that deadly? Is that force? Well, you could say that his lips were, what, deadly weapons as he gently kissed her, although she loved his lips? Is that what we're talking about? How about with regard to the supposed incident that happened on the 22nd of January of 2008? Is the indication or the written word that says nothing noteworthy happened at that time, is that an indication or is that telling you that he struck her? No, that's just the opposite. And how about the other incident that she claims that happened in August of 2007 after she was peeping inside his window and looking at him with another woman? What about that one? Well, that didn't happen that day. According to her, it happened the next day when he was banging his head up on the closet over and over. And according to her, that was when he didn't touch her but didn't want her to leave. Where, even under that stretch, it's still not physical violence. The last incident that she describes is the one that right before she left to go to Wairika, where supposedly she passed out. No indication whatsoever with regard to that one, because she claimed that she had visible bruises. No indication from the witness stand, other than from her, that she had bruises. No indication from anybody. And remember, what's interesting about that one is that she got that right before she left. And shortly after that, within 2 days, she was with her family when presumably these bruises would have been evident. You didn't hear from the witness stand at all that there were any bruises whatsoever. So then, there is no deadly physical force that can be even remotely available to her because he never touched her in that fashion again. It does say that a defendant may use deadly physical force in self-defense only to protect against another's use or apparent attempted or threatened use of physical force. She claims that he threatened physical force. Are you going to believe her? And remember, the earlier jury instruction talks about the situation where the credibility of witnesses is determined by applying it or thinking of it in terms of an important event in life. So with regard to important events in life, do you think anybody would take the defendant's statement? For example, an important event is what kind of medical care a child is going to receive. If you had a liar such as the defendant, would anybody take her advice as to how to take care of that individual? You wouldn't. And then it says, self-defense justifies the use or threat of deadly physical force only while the apparent danger continues. If there is no danger, there is no apparent danger. It also indicates that it ends when the apparent danger ends. If there is no apparent danger, then deadly physical force cannot be used. And additionally, it says the force used may not be greater than reasonably necessary to defend against the apparent danger. This individual, Mr. Alexander, was naked. He didn't have any deadly weapons on him. He was sopping wet. He was sitting there. There was no way that he could possibly threaten her at all. Just not at all. It does talk about what we just previously indicated, so that we can put it in context. The use of deadly physical force is justified if a reasonable person in the situation would have reasonably believed that immediate deadly physical danger appeared to be present. Actual danger is not necessary to justify the use of deadly physical force in self-defense. In this case, as I said before, there was never anything that you had from the witness stand other than from the defendant who indicated to you that she was fearful. And if she's the only person who indicated that and she has these credibility problems, it is clear that this standard isn't met. It says you must decide whether a reasonable person in a similar situation would believe that, and what is that that they have to believe? Deadly physical force was immediately necessary to protect against another's use or threatened use of lawful, unlawful deadly physical force. We've discussed this already. And then you must measure the defendant's belief against what a reasonable person in that situation would have believed. We've talked about that already. And it does say that a defendant has no duty to retreat before threatening or using deadly physical force in self-defense if the defendant has a legal right to be in the place where the use or threatened deadly physical force in self-defense occurred. Again, in order for this to apply, to say that she has no duty to retreat, you still have to look at what a reasonable person would have done. A reasonable person in these circumstances, as the defendant has described them, if they any of it were true, would be that there's a naked guy in the shower. And there's naked guy in the shower is mad at her, and she's already got a head start down the hallway. Well, if that's the case, and she's running away, this tells you that although she has no duty to retreat, a reasonable person would have taken a left other than a right, according to her.
Objection misstates the law.
Overruled.
Reasonable person would have just left. Is he going to follow her down the street naked? No, of course not. And was the second prong is was not engaged in an unlawful act at the time when the use or threatened deadly physical force in self-defense occurred. Again, there has to be this threat before this is even activated. It is true that the state has the burden of proving this beyond a reasonable doubt. You have to be firmly convinced. and it does tell you what happens if the state fails to carry this burden. The only evidence that you have in this particular case about whether or not the use of force here was justified, keep going back to it. It's like a parrot on a stick. I know I must sound like a parrot on a stick. Keep going back to the same thing. That would mean that you would have to believe the defendant. And the defendant is somebody who has demonstrated to you that throughout these proceedings, whether they be outside of the courtroom, in person to the detective, by telephone call to the detective, speaking with her friends, speaking to the psychologist, or coming in here and speaking here to you, throughout this whole thing, she has lied. It requires you to put all of that aside and say, something magical happened. And because something magical happened, I'm going to believe her as to this very limited thing, even though she's lied to us and she's lied to everybody else. And then it talks to you about whether or not there have been past acts of domestic violence against the defendant by the victim. Where are they? Where's the proof of that? There is absolutely nothing other than the defendant's own statements. And it talks about the state of mind of a reasonable person shall be determined from the perspective of a reasonable person who has been the victim of acts of domestic violence. But if there have been no acts of domestic violence that have been proven to you, then she does not fall in that category. And then it talks about what domestic violence means, and it lays out the relationship issue, and then it talks about what the potential crimes could be. Well, you're left now to decide whether or not as to premeditated murder, because they did not discuss the felony murder issue, whether or not there was any premeditation, or whether or not there's second degree, or whether or not this is manslaughter. It bears repeating, and you've seen these, that premeditated murder requires that the defendant, and we can personalize it, Jodi and Arias, caused or killed Travis Alexander. Yeah. She put that knife in really good in his chest. She slit his throat and she shot him in the face. Yeah, she did do that. And did Jodi Ann Arias intend or know that she would kill Travis Victor Alexander? Absolutely. That's why she went for the throat. That's why she just gutted him. And that's why she stuck it in his chest. And that's why she shot him in the face. There was this argument that, well, if she's dragging him back, she would have to aim. No, she wouldn't. He was shot in the right temple as opposed to them telling you it was the left temple. And if she's dragging him this way down the hallway, his right temple would be the one that would be most open to her. And she just took the gun and shot him. He was already dead at the time. And did Jodi Ann Arias act with premeditation? She did. Premeditation means that Jodi Ann Arias intended to kill Travis Victor Alexander. She sure did. She sure did. And after intending or knowing that she wanted to kill him, did she think about it? Well, sure she did. You think that she got the gun in Wairika, the 25 caliber, for any other reason other than to kill him? Do you think that all of these gyrations in preparation for her trip, or these preparations that she took, do you think that those were for any other reason other than to kill him? Do you think that she called Daryl Brewer and said, hey, I want these two gas cans because I'm going to Mesa, and then I'm going to lie to people about it? But do you think that she said that, do you think that she called him for any other reason other than that she wouldn't be found out that she was coming to Mesa? Of course not. And the fact that she bought a third gas can, that was for the purpose of going undetected. The fact that she turned off her cell phone, the fact that she took off the license plate when she arrived at his place, all of that was so she would go undetected when she killed him. And so she reflected. She thought about it or knew, which is what is required. And then it tells you that she didn't have to think of it for a long time. She can be a short period of time. It tells you that it's this reflection regardless of the length of time. In this case is unique in the sense that you have a continuing aspect of premeditation. You have a very long period of time in which he undertakes these preparations, and then you also have a shorter period of time in which he kills them three times over. And so there's the premeditation either way, and it tells you that's the difference between first degree and second degree. It also advises you that it is not, and I'll just read it, that while reflection is required for first degree murder, the time needed for reflection is not necessarily prolonged, and the space of time between the knowledge or the intent to kill and the killing of the defendant by the defendant of Travis Alexander may be very short. It does talk to you about premeditation not being the instant effect of a sudden quarrel or heat of passion. And I will point out to you again that Jodi Arias is the only person that indicates that there has been a sudden quarrel or heat of passion. Nothing in the scene itself indicates that. In fact, the scene indicates something else. She actually took some time to delete some photographs from the camera. She actually took time to make sure that she didn't get the bloody footprints onto the carpet. She took time to put the camera in the washing machine, and she took some extra time to kind of wipe up the scene, drag him back, and stick him in the shower. Now, the issue here is that, in terms of the instructions, if you find that the defendant is guilty of premeditated murder and or felony murder, which is the state's position, then you do not consider second-degree murder. You do not start with manslaughter and go up. You don't start with second-degree murder and go up. You start with first-degree murder. And once you're done with that first-degree murder calculation, that's the end of the story. Second-degree murder is the same thing as first-degree murder, except there's no premeditation. Clearly, in this case, there is premeditation. And manslaughter actually has another element that's added to it, in addition to what second-degree murder is. There has to be a sudden quarrel or heat of passion. And in order for it here, for there to be a sudden quarrel or heat of passion, the defendant has to be believed. But let's talk about manslaughter and the elements. It tells you that if and only if you find the elements of second degree murder were proven beyond a reasonable doubt, you must then consider whether the homicide was committed upon a sudden quarrel or heat of passion. That's the added element, resulting from adequate provocation by the victim. The provocation here is supplied by Jodi Arias. She's the one that's telling you that he's the one that came after her. But again, it's predicated on you believing her. And it talks about adequate provocation means conduct or circumstances sufficient to deprive a reasonable person of self-control. Well, if it's Ms. Arias that is telling you, is there even any provocation whatsoever? It does say that words alone are not adequate provocation to justify reducing an intentional killing to manslaughter. If a naked guy, as Mr. Alexander was, is in the shower shouting at you, that's not enough to justify manslaughter. Because you can imagine how many situations there are when people get into shouting matches and that's not appropriate to then shoot them or stab them or slit their throat. And then it talks about a cooling off period between the provocation, i.e., and the killing. And the cooling off period is the time it would take a reasonable person to regain control under the circumstances. Since there is no proof whatsoever that there was any provocation on behalf of the victim.
Objection, burden shifting.
There is no indication whatsoever that Mr. Alexander did anything other than what the defendant says. And according to her, he said a fifth grader, some or words to that effect, could take better pictures than you. That's not sufficient provocation. It goes on that if you do find the elements of second-degree murder were proven beyond a reasonable doubt, and then it tells you how to decide this case if you find yourself in that position. It is the state's view that nothing in this case indicates that this was anything other than a slaughter. other than a premeditated killing of a guy, Travis Victor Alexander, who just didn't want to have anything to do with her. There's no indication here that he went to visit her. Yes, there was a telephone call that was made, and yes, they were enjoying, or he was enjoying himself, and apparently, according to what the phone call sounds like, she was enjoying herself. But what actually seems, or what is going on here, because we can say this as a result of the May 19th, 2008 instant message, is that Mr. Alexander had tired of her. And he knew of the history. He knew of the stalking behavior that she had. And he was done with her. And so he told her that he was done with her. And he also indicated that he was extremely afraid because of her stalking behavior. And he was prophetic in that. What ends up happening is that on May 26th, they have this argument. You've seen the argument. He says, it's the worst thing that's ever happened to him. And that's true. And so what ends up happening again is that it's as if he were pronouncing his own death sentence. And then she undertakes to carry this out. It isn't like he requested it. It isn't like he did anything other than attempt to sort of appease this woman that just wouldn't leave him alone. Whether it be by coming over, sleeping underneath the Christmas tree, taking a ring that didn't belong to her, peeping in his window, doing all of those things that she did, moving to Mesa after he broke up with her, or they broke up, going into his computer, hitting the backspace button, breaking into his MySpace account, all of those things indicate to you that her motivation for this was that she just wanted him. She came over, and what is one act of wanting an individual? Well, to demonstrate that you want an individual is you engage in sexual intercourse. And that's what she did on that particular day. She wanted him. She couldn't let him go. Even from Wairika, she couldn't let him go. There's never an indication that he said that he requested her to come there. Those are her words, and she kept saying them over and over like mantra. And so on that date, when she finally got there, she came ready to go. And by ready to go, I mean she brought over the weapons, and she spent some time with him. And then when he was in the shower, he was no match for her. And she took care of business. And you know how she took care of business. And because she took care of business, and because she stabbed him in the heart, and because she slashed his throat, and because she shot him in the face, and because she premeditated it, you now have a duty. And this duty requires you to take into account the jury instructions, and these jury instructions are not something that you can disregard. They're mandatory. Apply them to the facts, and the facts, again, involve an individual who has lied consistently throughout. And based on that, you are to reach a decision as to whether or not the defendant committed first-degree murder. In a circumstance like this, again, you can only make reference to what other people have said, perhaps with regard to other important times of their life. And there's a poet, John Donne, and again, it's just a reference to him. It's close to the quote, but the reference that I want to leave you with is that when you're involved in this sort of situation, you have to sit back and you think about it, and you think about what is going on. And he wrote, every person's death diminishes. So therefore, send no one to find for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. And in this case, what it's telling you is that you now have the burden to apply this and to the facts that were presented. And in doing so, I am asking you to return a verdict of first-degree murder. Not only of premeditated murder, but also of felony murder. Not because it's an emotional decision that I want you to reach like them by saying that something's nonsensical and that sort of thing, or making an argument just for its own sake. But because in this case, Travis Victor Alexander was slaughtered by this woman
objection in front of our...
When she slashed his throat, she stabbed him in the heart, and then she shot him in the face, and all of that, thinking about it in advance. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please turn to page 2 of your jury instructions. I want to repeat two instructions I gave you yesterday. In their opening statements and closing arguments, the lawyers have talked to you about the law and the evidence. What the lawyers said is not evidence, but it may help you to understand the law and the evidence. Evidence means the testimony of witnesses and exhibits introduced in court. The law is the jury instructions, your final jury instructions. Now please turn to page 20. The case is now submitted to you for decision. When you go to the jury room, you will choose a foreperson. He or she will preside over your deliberations. I suggest that you discuss and then set your deliberation schedule. You are in charge of your schedule and may set and vary it by agreement and with approval of the court. After you have decided on a schedule, please advise the bailiff. As jurors, you have a duty to discuss the case with one another and to deliberate in an effort to reach a just verdict. Each of you must decide the case for yourself, but only after you consider the evidence impartially with your fellow jurors. During your deliberations, you should not hesitate to re-examine your own views and change your opinion if you become convinced that it is wrong. However, you should not change your honest belief concerning the weight or effect of the evidence solely because of the opinion of your fellow jurors or for the mere purpose of returning a verdict. You are to discuss the case and deliberate only when all jurors are together in the jury room. You are not to discuss the case with each other or anyone else during breaks or recesses. The admonition I have given you during the trial remains in effect when all of you are not in the jury room deliberating. After setting your schedule, I suggest that you next review the written jury instructions and verdict form. It may be helpful for you to discuss the instructions and verdict form to make sure that you understand them. Again, during your deliberations, you must follow the instructions and refer to them to answer any questions about applicable law, procedure, and definitions. Should any of you or the jury as a whole have a question for me during your deliberations or wish to communicate with me on any other matter, please utilize the jury question form that we will provide you. Your question or message must be communicated to me in writing and must be signed by you or the foreperson. I will consider your question or note and consult with counsel before answering it in writing. I will answer it as quickly as possible. Remember that you are not to tell anyone, including me, how you stand numerically or otherwise until after you have reached a verdict or have been discharged. During your deliberations, you must not communicate with or provide any information to anyone by any means about this case. You may not use any electronic device or media such as a telephone, cell phone, smartphone, iPhone, BlackBerry or computer, the internet, any internet service, or any text or instant messaging service, or any internet chat room, blog or website such as Facebook, MySpace, LinkedIn, YouTube or Twitter, to communicate to anyone any information about this case or to conduct any research about this case until I accept your verdict. All 12 of you must agree on each verdict. You must be unanimous. Once all 12 agree on a verdict, only the foreperson need sign the verdict form on the line marked foreperson. You will be given one form of verdict. The verdict form reads as follows. Count one. We, the jury, duly impaneled and sworn in the above entitled action upon our oaths do find the defendant as to count one, first degree murder. Not guilty or guilty, you will check the appropriate box. Complete this portion of the verdict form only if you find the defendant guilty of first degree murder. If your verdict is guilty of first degree murder, indicate the number of jurors finding each type of first degree murder. And there are three different elections to be made. The number of jurors finding only premeditated murder, the number of jurors finding only felony murder, and the number of jurors finding both premeditated murder and felony murder. The foreperson will then sign the verdict form and print his or her name. To be completed only if not guilty or undecided on count one first-degree murder. We, the jury, duly impaneled and sworn in the above-entitled action upon our oaths to find the defendant on the charge of second-degree murder as follows, not guilty or guilty. You will check the appropriate box. To be completed only if not guilty or undecided on count one second-degree murder. We, the jury, duly impaneled and sworn in the above-entitled action upon our oaths to find the defendant on the charge of manslaughter as follows, not guilty or guilty. The foreperson will then sign their verdict form and print his or her name. All right, ladies and gentlemen, there are 15 of you. At this time, the clerk will select the alternate jurors by lot.
Juror number 10.
Juror 10.
Juror number 17.
Juror 17.
Juror number 15.
Juror 15. All right, those of you who have been selected as the alternates, the admonition will continue to apply to you. If for some reason one of the sitting jurors cannot continue, you will substitute for a sitting juror. So, I'm going to ask that the alternate jurors report back here on Monday at 9 a.m. and be present when the jury is deliberating. You will be seated in a special area. The bailiff will direct you where you should report. The admonition will continue to apply. All right, at this time, the bailiffs will be sworn.
You do solemnly swear to take charge of this jury and protect their deliberations from all outside interference, so help you God.
Thank you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, you may go back to the jury room and begin deliberating. The alternate jurors will also go back to the jury room, collect your things, and the bailiffs will show you where you will be reporting on Monday. You are excused.
Please stand for the jury.
Record will show the jury has left the courtroom. Please be seated. Counsel, are there any objections to the final instructions as read?
No, thank you.
None, Your
Honor. Please approach counsel. We are at recess.